I'd like to begin by inviting all of you to close your eyes for a second and put in your mind an image of what you think of when you hear the word Reformation. Okay, got an image? Go ahead and open up your eyes again. I think that some of us in the room would have an image kind of like this one in the background, where we've got this guy, Martin Luther, doing some carpentry work on the church doors in Wittenberg in 1517. And this particular Reformation started off in the religious domain, but it expanded and it had profound societal implications. That's not the Reformation I would like to talk to you about today. What is it that we want to reform? What needs to be reformed again? Well, I think it's probably safe to say that none of us here, or at least very few of us, are just completely delighted with the state of society at this moment. We're in the middle of a climate crisis and we are not doing nearly enough to solve it. We're watching biodiversity being washed away across the globe at rates that rival previous global mass extinctions, and humans are the cause of that at this point. We're seeing inequality grow around the world to levels that we haven't seen for a century or so. We're deeply dissatisfied, I think, most all of us, with the state of politics wherever it is that we live, and yet we're very, very deeply divided as to what we perceive the causes of that dissatisfaction to be. So it seems to me that we're on a trajectory that might lead us to a point that's so nicely depicted by this Tom Toro cartoon, where, boy, we trashed the planet, but at least we created a lot of shareholder value while we did it. Okay? So being on a trajectory like this is a result of decisions that we've made. It's a result of choices that we make. And I believe that we can make better choices in the future. But to do that, I think it's useful to try to figure out what are some of the driving forces that put us on this trajectory. And for me, I think one of those driving forces is this. It's the idea that humans, man, oftentimes, humans and nature are different, they're separate. And not only are humans and nature separate, humans are better than nature. Humans are above nature. And nature is simply something that we can exploit as we wish. Okay, so I'd like to explore some of the consequences of that particular mindset, but before we do that, let's try to figure out where the heck that idea came from. Okay, so that idea has very deep roots in Western thought, but the person that gets perhaps more credit or blame, I suppose, depending on how you look at it, is the guy on the left here, René Descartes. Now, René Descartes thought that we were special. We humans were special. And I took a bunch of Descartes' ideas and I threw them at the DALL-E AI, and I asked the DALL-E AI to come up with an image that represented these ideas. And that's what you see on the right. Okay, so basically it goes something like this. We humans, we have this big brain, and we can use this big brain to come up with new ideas. And we can communicate those ideas to other humans. And it didn't appear to Descartes that any other animal or thing on the planet could do that, so that made us special. But Descartes also thought that we have a soul. And nothing else on the planet had a soul. And that made us not only different from the rest of nature, but it made us superior to the rest of nature. It's the Cartesian dualism, it's called. Okay, so let's try to explore a bit some of the consequences of this Cartesian dualism, this thought. So the tapestry that is our society has lots of threads in its warp and its weft, and many of those threads are colored by this idea that we and nature are separate from each other. But I'd like to pull on just one of those threads this afternoon, and that's how this particular idea might affect how we think about the economy, because the economy is kind of important for us in society. Okay, so let's start here. And I think at least the economists in the room should recognize this image, right? I'm looking at, no? Well, this, of course, is Adam Smith's invisible hand, okay? And there we have Adam Smith. Now, in 1776, Adam Smith wrote a book that was called An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations. And in that book, he came up with the idea that, look, if all of us individuals made rational and ethical choices that maximized our own welfare, our own utility, then society, being just a collection of all of us individuals, would end up at the very acme, the best point that we could possibly reach. Society would be guided as if by an invisible hand to the best possible solution. Now, there was a lot more than that in that particular book, but I think that's been misinterpreted badly through time to draw the conclusion that we should just behave selfishly, right? That's the best thing that we can do. All right, so let's park that idea for a moment and go on to another person. This is the Nobel laureate, Milton Friedman. This is 200 years later. In 1970, Milton Friedman published an article in the New York Times where he said that the social responsibility of business is to increase its profits. That's it. Nothing else. Okay? All this stuff about talking about the environment, the social issues, the governance issues, forget about it. Increase your profits. That's the only thing that business should be doing. All right, so let's put those two ideas together and you come to the conclusion that, hey, greed is good. All right, so let's switch threads for a moment to one that has to do with how we relate to resources and put yourself back in the middle of the Great Depression, 1932. Okay, there's lots of ideas being bandied around. How do we get out of this Great Depression? What can we do to get out of the Great Depression? And one of those ideas was that if we had stuff, if we had goods, and those goods had a finite lifetime, then when that good stopped working, or when it broke, I'd have to go buy another one. And I'd have to buy it from a shop that sold me those goods, and then somebody would have to have a job to make the goods that I was buying, and that'd be a good thing, right? That would get us out of the Great Depression. Okay, now, in the intervening time, I think that idea has been perverted very badly into actually building in finite lifetimes into many of the goods that we have, or making them so difficult to repair that we buy new ones instead of fixing the ones that we've got, or even worse, convincing us that we absolutely need to have the latest generation of smartphone or the latest generation of fashion, despite the fact that the previous smartphone works perfectly well still. Okay, let's continue on with resources and come to this fellow, another Nobel laureate, Robert Solow. Now, Solow in the 50s and since then worked on theories for economic growth, and along the way, he and colleagues came up with a very simple relationship, a very simple equation, talking about production. And Solow and Bunch and Company said, okay, so production, Q, is the product of three terms. It's a product of resources, R. It's the product of capital, or resources times capital, times labor, which is L, capital's K. All right, so I've rearranged that equation a little bit here to emphasize the relationship between capital and resources in that mindset. And it goes something like this. If you look at that equation, on the right-hand side, you see capital that we're dividing by capital. That means if capital gets really, really big, if we get really, really rich, then resources goes to zero. It gets really, really small. Now, this equation allowed Solow to say in a speech in 1974 to the American Economics Association that the world can get by really without natural resources. Put those two ideas together and you get this drive to overuse resources. And if you put both of those ideas together and then filter them through the prism that we humans and nature are completely separate from each other, then I think you inevitably come to the conclusion or come to the state where we have an unjust and unsustainable society. Okay, we don't want that. We might want to have something that looks a little bit more like this. At the basis of this image is nature. Functioning, resilient, flourishing ecosystems. Without nature, we cannot build a society. But let's say that we got those. Okay, off we go. We build a society, and then we decide, we make decisions about what elements we want to have in that society. And we can have elements like markets, we can have elements like corporations, we can have governments. And we can have informed discussions about the relative influence, the relative size of those bubbles, and how they might relate to each other. Maybe there are bubbles that we need that aren't on this image. But this is something that we can aspire to, right? This image, I think, shows kind of where we are today, where we've allowed markets and we've allowed the corporations to act within them to be completely dominant and squeeze out the role that governments might have. And we can see that the unchecked consumption and the badly regulated pollution that these activities cause are very rapidly and very seriously eroding away the natural foundation on which our society is built. Clearly, a point that we don't want to be at. How do we get to this particular better point? That's where Reformation 2 comes in, 2.0. I think Reformation 2.0 will require of us that we reassess the very foundational assumptions that our society is based on. And I think it requires of us to ask this question: what if humans and nature aren't separate from each other? What would the world look like then? Now, there are cultures around the world in which the separation between humans and nature never occurred. It was never a thing. I'm not part of one of those cultures, so I can't represent them properly to you, but I would like to share some words that were written by somebody who was part of one of those cultures with you. Viola Cordova was a Native American philosopher. She passed away in 2002, but she left us with a very deep and rich, and I find inspiring body of work, and I would like to share just some of the words that Viola Cordova wrote with you today. In the reality of most Native Americans, man is not an isolated and self-sufficient unit of existence. Man is a group being and dependent not only on others, but on the earth. Survival depends not on competition, but on cooperation. Man is not a being in opposition to nature, but a part of it. Nature gives him his subsistence, the group gives him his identity. Just as man owes something to his fellows, he feels indebted to the earth. Earth is the context of his being. He and the context he exists in are one. There is no existence for man outside this context. The ethical system of the Native American extends beyond man's relationship with others and the institutions that men create. The Native American includes the earth and everything in it in his ethical system. This is a very important fact in determining the well-being of a man. Now, when I try to digest those very wise words, this image comes to mind for me. This image was taken by Bill Anders, astronaut Bill Anders, on the Apollo 8 mission. It's the Earthrise image. It also, those words remind me of other words written by another wise woman, Donella Meadows. Now, Donella Meadows was working on complex systems and how you intervene in complex systems. And she said there was two ways of doing that, and that was through shallow leverage points or deep leverage points. And shallow leverage points are things like taxes or regulations, and they work. They help, but they don't change the nature of the system itself. If you want to change the nature of the system itself, you need to access deep leverage points. And those are things like deciding what the goals of the system are, or deciding the mindset out of which that system arises. And I think Reformation 2.0 is about changing that mindset, about deciding whether we want to view this beautiful planet that we have as a fungible resource that we can trade off against capital, or we can trade off against some sort of technological innovation, or do we want to create, do we want to conceive of that as a miracle? Sometimes when I talk about these sorts of very deep transitions, transformations, I get the response that, come on, Kevin, get a life. These things, it's all touchy-feely, it's not going to work. These transitions are too complex, they're too expensive, we don't know how to do them, they'll take too long, it's not going to happen. And my reply to those reply is a simple one, and that is horse pucky. Okay. And I will defend that response with this image. And this image was taken in Alaska in the 30th of April, 1909. Now think about this for a moment. This image was taken from the same planet that we share, but was taken from a very different world. And the person at the left-hand side of this image is my grandfather, Frank Noone. Okay, so Frank, everybody, Frank. Now, Frank and company were in Alaska looking for gold, which they did not find, but that's not the important thing about the image. The important thing about the image is their transportation method, which was horses and sledges. So in the two generations' time between my grandfather and myself, we have already transformed our transportation sector completely. We've already transformed our energy sector completely. We've already transformed our agricultural sector. We've invented a couple of important sectors that didn't even exist when my grandfather was around. So the idea that these transformations can't occur or they won't happen or they're too expensive, nonsense. We need to do them again. We need to do them more rapidly and we need to do them more smarter. Okay. I think that in planning these transitions, in planning these transformations, our point of departure has to be a mindset of collaboration and cooperation. We have to start off with the mindset that humans and nature are completely intertwined. We have to free our imaginations to come up with a world that works for everybody and not just a fortunate few. We need to have the courage and the discipline to set aside the mindsets that haven't been working for us or won't work for us into the future and replace them with ones that will, because we don't want to keep going down a very dangerous path. We need to all of us create a future world that we would be proud to hand off to future generations. We need a Reformation 2.0. Let's get started. Thank you.